محمد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله العليم الخبير المتقن نظام العالم بلا معين ونصير فسبحان الله الذي حكمته بالغة وعلمه غزير ونعمه واصلة إلى كل صغير وكبير ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له في نقير ولا قطمير ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله الذي هدانا بكتاب منير ودعانا إلى الله بالإنذار والتبشير صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ما دامت الكواكب تسير أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما جعلنا لبشر من قبلك الخلد أفإن مت فهم الخالدون صدق الله العظيم. Honorable scholars, respected brothers, elders and esteemed listeners, so in our previous episode, we concluded on the profound couplets of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, wherein he reminded us that our stay in this world was transitory, and in a short span of six months, he had to contend with the tragic demise of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his spouse. We can imagine his spouse was not a regular spouse, was the daughter of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and we also know that she was the only one who survived at the demise of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam from all his children. From all the children of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, from the seven children that Allah had endowed him, one was Ibrahim from Maria Qibtiya radiallahu anha, which had passed away in his infancy. And then he sallallahu alayhi wasallam had six children born to him by Khadija radiallahu anha. All out of the six, five had passed on. That is basically Zainab radiallahu anha, who was wedded to Abu al-As ibn al-Rabi, who was the nephew of Khadija radiallahu anha, Ruqayya and Umm Kulthum respectively to Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhuma, Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu. So all three of them had passed on. Fatima radiallahu anha was the only daughter, and she was 29 when she passed on. So she had not even seen the age of 30. And of course, the two sons that were born to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Qasim and Tahir, as he sallallahu alayhi wasallam is known as Abu al-Qasim, they had all passed on as well in their infancy. So we were still mentioning the different verses. Some verses were implicit about the demise of Nabi alayhi salam, and some were explicit. We spoke about two verses and we move on with the third verse. وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ. So as I mentioned in the previous segment as well, that the kuffar used to often raise this argument. It's okay, he's here for a few days, he'll move on. His faith will die a natural death. It will just fizzle away. We prophets came and went, and this is how it moves on. So he's got some prominence, some momentum, some flavor, some recognition, but it's just a matter of time. And Allah counters this by saying, أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ أَفَإِن مِتَّ, if you pass on, will they live? No, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ, every soul will taste death. And the scholars also use this verse to refute those who argue that Khidr, because there is this great discussion that happens, is Khidr alayhi salam alive or not, etc., etc. And those who use the proof that he has moved on, which is wal jumhur ala annahu mat, the overriding and overwhelming view, they also support it through this ayah amongst other proof. The one hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where he said, whoever is on the earth today, a century later, they will not be alive. He sallallahu alayhi wasallam had mentioned this here. So, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ, we have not made immortality for any human on this earth. أَفَإِمَّاتَ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ, if the Prophet moves on, will they live forever? No, this is not going to happen. ثُمَّ أَعْقَبَ ذَلِكَ بِبَيَانِ أَنَّ الْمَوْتَ حَتْمٌ لَازِمٌ وَقَدْرٌ سَابِقٌ فَقَدْ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first spoke about the fact that no human will enjoy immortality. We are mortals and we all will have to move on. And then Allah followed the discussion. أَعْقَبَ يُعْقِبُ وَيَعْقَابُ. Allah followed the discussion by saying, أَنَّ الْمَوْتَ حَتْمٌ لَازِمٌ. الْمَوْتَ لَيْسَ مِنْهُ الْفَوْتِ. That there's simply no form of escaping from it. إِنَّ الْحَبِيبَ مِنَ الْأَحْبَابِ مُخْتَلَسُ لَا يَمْنَعُ الْمَوْتَ بَوَّابٌ وَلَا حَرَسُ. Regardless of the measures or security that you have, there's no way you can block or avert destiny and death. فهذه الآيات صريحة ونصت على وفاته صلى الله عليه وسلم. These verses are explicit, categoric, that speak clearly about the inevitable reality that he صلى الله عليه وسلم will pass on. وهناك بعض الآيات أشارت إلى ذلك وإن لم تصرح منها. Now there were other verses which I had mentioned in my forward and my tamheed that were implicit, that released a gentle hint. The prominent Sahaba picked up the hint, others did not pick up. How often when a person passes on, and then in hindsight, you start analyzing the weeks leading up to his death or her death. And then you say, you know, 2 weeks ago, he said, no, let's just wrap it up. I don't think we'll meet again. I'm not sure. And at that time, you don't read too deep into it. You think it's regular. Probably he'll be engaged or he might be traveling or there might be some host of other occupation. And post his demise or her demise, you start analyzing it critically and you realize that that was a gentle hint released by him that, you know what, we might not mean, we will not meet again on this earth. So there were many verses that gave a subtle hint. وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. And surely the latter, that is akhirah, is better for you than the former. That is, the year after is greater for you than this world. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And undoubtedly your Lord will grant you until you are pleased. Allah will reward you and grant you and bless you until you are pleased. And I'm reminded of a hadith of a verse of the Quran regarding Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. That the narration is in Hakim and the verse is in Wallayl, where he was displaying amazing kindness towards many of the poor Muslims, the likes of Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu anhu and others. Jazallahu anna atiqan. May Allah reward Abu Bakr wa akhza faqihan wa aba jahli ashiyatan hamma fi bilalin bi sawati wa lam yahdhara ma yahdharu al mar'u dhul aqli bi tawhidihi rabbal anami wa qawlihi shahidtu bi anna Allah rabbi. فَإِنْ يَقْتُلُونِي يَقْتُلُونِي فَلَمْ أَكُنْ لِأُشْرِكَ بِالرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ خِيفَةِ الْقَتْلِ فَيَا رَبَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ فَيَا رَبَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَمُوسَى وَعَبْدَ يُونُسٍ نَجِّنِي ثُمَّ لَا تُبْلِي. It's a long poem in which the poet says, جَزَى اللَّهُ عَنَّا عَتِيقًا. May Allah reward Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu on our behalf. وَأَخْزَى فَاكِهًا. Faqih ibn Mughira, who was the uncle of Abu Jahl. Faqih ibn Mughira, وَأَخْزَى فَاكِهًا وَأَبَى جَهْلِ. That they too collectively plotted for the assassination of Sayyidina Bilal and others. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu used to liberate these poor Sahaba. So his dad Abu Quhafa, who was not a Muslim at that time, he once said to him that you're going to get no return from these people, at least liberate people with muscle and clout. So in an event, if you need some bodyguards, you can call on them and they will be morally obligated to respond because on their shoulders will be your favor of their liberation. And he said that I try to assist people in whom I do not see any remote hope of remuneration so that I can take my full reward from Allah. And then Allah revealed the verse, وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Look at the rank and the status of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى. He's not offsetting the favor of anyone. إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى. He's exclusively driven to please Allah when he's reaching out to the people. And honestly, you know what? Serving mankind is a great thing. I was in Jordan last week and we were inaugurating a village for Syrian refugees. And there was a brother by the name of Abu Nasir. And I won't forget this. Of course, it's fresh at this stage. While we were doing a tour and I was doing an interview and some reports, he said, Sheikh, ahki laka qissa. I said, please tell me. And then he's telling me, I want to share something with you, which I don't generally share with people. I was working in US and I was working for United Nations. And one day I had a dream. And in the dream, I seen the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhumah. And I enter in this room, there's this precious stones. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, take these stones, take these gems and these pearls and these precious stones. And I take it and I put it in my right pocket. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells me, put in your left pocket. And I put in my left pocket. And he Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells me, fill your upper garment as well. So I fill my upper garment. And he Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells me, now put some in your mouth as well. And I just cannot get adequate and I cannot get enough of it. And I then enjoy it and I fill myself up and I'm, you know, wrapped up in all these precious stones. And I get up in the morning and I then phone a scholar back in Jordan, because he's from Jordan. And I ask him the interpretation of this dream. And he said, soon Allah will deploy you to assist the need of the orphans and the widows. And he said, that's the interpretation. And he's an active member of Al-Hay'atul Khayriya, Al-Urduniya, Al-Hashimiya, which is the charity wing of the king, the national charity organization. And of course, we had partnered with him doing the work. So anyway, may Allah make us amongst those people. I just said, well, so, you know, إلا ابتغاء وجه ربه الأعلى, driven exclusively for the pleasure of Allah, ولسوف يرضى, and soon he will be happy. Another verse of the Quran, كل من عليها فان. Like we said, these are implicit that are releasing gentle hints. كل من عليها فان, whoever is on this earth will perish, will cease, will die, will pass on. ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام, and only the being, the mighty power and the great, Almighty will remain. Other than that, everybody else will perish. مَا عِنْدَكُمْ يَنْفَدْ وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ بَاقٍ. Whatever is by us is bound to perish, is meant to perish. And yet another verse of the Quran, Surah Qasas, in the 20th juz, in fact, the concluding verse of Surah Qasas, كُلُّ شَيْءٍ هَالِكٍ. Everything is perishable. Everything will cease to exist. Everything will come to an end, but the being of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lahu al-hukmu, it is His power, it is His command, it is His authority. Wa ilayhi turja'un, and to Him everyone will return. Fahadhihi al-ayat, all these verses indicate to us that the system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that humans will come and go, and this is the pattern of life. لَنْ يَتَخَلَّفْ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدْ أَبَدًا. There is simply no exception to this. Yeah, there is simply no exception to it. And then another verse, which was also a gentle and a subtle, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. It's on one of the last verses that were revealed. So the last verse to be revealed was وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. The last chapter to be revealed was Surah An-Nasr. One of the last verses to be revealed was الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ يَسْتَفْتُونَكَ قُلِ اللَّهُ يُفْتِيكُمْ فِي الْكَلَالَةِ, regarding a person that doesn't have any ascendance or descendants, how his estate will be distributed. These were amongst the final verses. But the absolute last verse, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And the verse revealed on Friday, on the day of Arafah, between Asr and Maghrib, was this verse. الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. Now, we know the beauty of the Arabic language, the difference between إِكْمَال and إِتْمَام. In إِكْمَال, what happens is that بَيْنَهُمَا فُصُول مُتَقَطِّعَ. إِكْمَال can be, أَكْمَلَ يُكْمِلُ إِكْمَال means to complete. أَتَمَّ يُتِمُّ إِتْمَام also means to complete and culminate. However, linguistically, there's a difference between the two. إِكْمَال is something that can allow for interval, while itmam is something that is not interjected. It is continuous. There's no interruption in it. So a simple analogy, when we refer to fast, Allah says, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Then complete your fast to the night. You cannot stop your fast and halt it. Once you've commenced your fast, you resume till the end. وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ. Complete your Hajj and Umrah for Allah. Once you've donned the Ihram, you cannot exit the state of Ihram until you've completed the rituals of Hajj. While Ikmal will be something that is gradual, بَيْنَهُمَا مَرَاحِلْ مُتَقَطِّعَ فَوَاصِلْ زَمَنِيَّ. There could be time, there could be period, there could be intervals. So we know revelation came over 23 years. It was interjected. Hence Allah said, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. Your faith has been completed. But in this 23 years, where revelation was interjected, the bounty of Allah continued, unabated, relentless. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي. So the favor of Allah was right through the 23 years, and of course the favor of Allah continues. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا, and I'm pleased with Islam as your religion. And this is mentioned in this book as well, and in Ibn Kathir I've read it. وَقَدْ بَكَى عُمَرُ بْنُ الْخَطَّابِ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ حِينَ نَزَلَتِ الْآيَةِ. Just look at the understanding of Sahaba. Sayyidina Umar started crying. It was a day of Eid. It was a day of rejoicing. From that day, the scholars say the Prophet ﷺ lived for about 82 days. So now you right close up, just about, just so you know what, under three months, you're getting very, very close. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu cried, and we know the famous incident that the Yahudi came to him and said that if we had a verse like this, لَتَّخَذْنَاهَا عِيدًا, we would have made it a day of celebration. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, for us, it is a day of celebration because it's Eid, paired up with Arafah, so it's a dual sense of joy. But as much as the ayah gave of the good news of the culmination and the completion and the perfection of the faith, the likes of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu teared. And when it was asked to him, ma yubakik, what makes you cry? And listen to his answer. He said, innahu laysa ba'da al-kamal illa nuqsan. When something reaches its culmination, its perfection, then inevitably what happens? You start having an anticlimax. You start having a drop. You start having a decline. You start having things coming down. So after Arafah, you're crying. No, but there's still Muzdalifah, correct. But there's a hype towards Arafah. And then things just start dipping down. It just start dipping down. So you're anticipating, you're hoping, you're looking forward, you're exerting, you're moving up, you're sustaining momentum. And the norm and the nature is that just after that happens, you see 27th night, Quran is completed, things just dip down. إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ بَعْدَ الْكَمَالِ إِلَّا النُّقْصَانِ Subhanallah, you know, the understanding of Sahaba through ayah. And that is why we need to know that basic Arabic, to start off, not even basic Arabic is adequate, but even if you're intense in Arabic and you're thorough in Arabic, you cannot be independent of the interpretation of Sahaba in understanding the Quran, because they were the closest. The verse of the Quran in the 25th Juz, مَا أَصَابَكُم مِّن مُصِيبَةٍ فَبِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَيَعْفُوا عَنْ كَثِيرٍ. Whatever trials you are afflicted with is because of the doings of your hands. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu used to say, هَذِهِ أَرْجَى آيَةٍ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. This ayah gives me the greatest hope. So people said, why? He said, because الْكَرِيمُ إِذَا عَاقَبَ مَرَّةً لَا يُعَاقِبُ مَرَّةً أُخْرَى. A kind being, if he has subjected you to the consequences of your wrong once, he won't subject you for a second time. So Allah said, your afflictions are as a result of your doings. So that means we're going through a purification process just to make it a clean slate, that when we appear before Allah, we're done. Now, where would our mind ever grasp this hint from the verse of the Quran? Just the other day, I was reading a verse, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. We read it in Surah Balad. In Ma'riful Quran, there's an amazing deduction mentioned there. Surely we've created man in difficulty. That's the translation. In other words, the nature of existence on planet Earth is riddled with challenges. عِشْ فِي الدُّنْيَا مُوسِرًا إِنْ شِئْتَ أَوْ مُوسِرًا لَابُدَّ فِي الدُّنْيَا مِنَ الْغَمِّ دُنْيَاكَ بِالْأَحْزَانِ مَقْرُونَ لَا تَقْطَعُ الدُّنْيَا بِلَا هَمِّ عِشْ فِي الدُّنْيَا مُوسِرًا إِنْ شِئْتَ أَوْ مُوسِرًا. Live wealthy or live like a pauper. دُنْيَاكَ بِالْأَحْزَانِ مَقْرُونَ. The nature of existence on planet Earth is inseparable from tragedies. This is how we live. So Allah says that we have decreed and ordained a life of challenges. You know what the scholars of tafsir say? This ayah, on a subtle note, refutes the myth of the atheist and an agnostic. What? Atheist believes that everything came into existence by itself and without any divine or supreme being. And it refutes this. Why? Because if we were the architects of our own life and we designed our own life, we wouldn't have designed a difficult life. We would design an easy life. So, wow, look at the ayah and look at the deduction. The ayah releases a hint refuting the myth that humans, ask anyone, because your whole aim of being an atheist and an agnostic and refuting is, you know, things happen with cause and effect. So you structure and design and you the architect. So every human would have structured his own life. Allah said, we decided your inheritance, because if you had to decide your inheritance, you would have based it on who from your family benefits you more. That's how you would have designed it. And the truth is, you don't know who will benefit you more. أَبَاؤُكُمْ وَأَبَنَاؤُكُمْ لَا تَدْرُونَ أَيُّهُمْ أَقْرَبُ لَكُمْ نَفْعًا. Ask a man, who must you give weight? I'll see. And that's what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, لَا تَعْجَلْ فِي مَدْحِ أَحَدٍ وَلَا فِي ذَمِّهِ فَإِنَّهُ رُبَّ مَنْ يَسُرُّكَ الْيَوْمِ يَسُوءُكَ غَدًا وَرُبَّ مَنْ يَسُوءُكَ الْيَوْمِ يَسُرُّكَ غَدًا. Don't be hasty in praising or criticizing. Some will praise you today, depress you tomorrow. Some will please you today, impress you today, depress you tomorrow. Some will depress you today, impress you tomorrow. And if I can say a word here to the parents and guardians, often the child that's most turbulent in his early years turns out to be the biggest source of happiness for his parents in the latter years. So we don't know. So anyway, I'm saying if we were to base inheritance, it would be on who benefits us most. And we don't know. Hence, Allah has legislated our inheritance. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَدْ. The point I'm trying to impress upon you, respected listener, brother and sister, is that how the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, understood the different hints from the verses of the Quran. And then came the chapter of the Quran, إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. And when the help of Allah comes and victory comes, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ, and you will see people يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا, entering into Islam in droves, in scores, in multitudes, in nations. So you would see in the early stages, it was Islamu Rajulin, Islamu Rajulaini, Islamu Qawmin, and then became Wufud, Wufud. So in the early stages, if you see the books of Da'wah, the Prophet ﷺ spoke to one person. He spoke to Dhimad radiallahu anhu, and Dhimad was very learned and he was a medical practitioner and people had indoctrinated him. And then he came and he said, can I treat you and cure you? And I have helped many people. And Nabi ﷺ was calm and composed and heard what he said. And then Nabi ﷺ said, Alhamdulillahi ahmaduhu wa astaghinuhu wa astaghfiru man yahdihillahu fala mudilla lah. And he said, A'id alayya hadhihi al-kalimat, repeat those words for me. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam repeated it. He said, Laqad balaghna qamus al-bahri. That's the pinnacle of eloquence. Who said you are, naive or sick or ill or not mentally stable? That allegation should be directed to the people who said it. Give me your hand. Halumma yadak ubayi'ka. Give me your hand. And he takes the shahada. ثم أتى ضماد وهو الأزدي ما هو إلا أن محمدا خطب أسلم للوقت وذهب ثم أتى ضماد. Then came ضماد from the Azdi tribe, right? ثم أتى ضماد وهو الأزدي ما هو إلا أن محمدا خطب. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم only began his khutbah. Now, they were Arabs, they could understand and comprehend and appreciate the profound nature. Aslama lil waqti wa dhahab. So your initial stages were the one, the two, the few, the families. And then towards the latter part, look at Fath Makkah, look at Hunain, look at Hawazin. Oh wow, it's just droves and scores and multitudes. 10,000 people march at the conquest of Makkah, and Hajjatul Wada witnessed more than 124,000. And this is a short period of time. So there's this major transformation. وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا. And you witness and observe people entering into the fold in scores and multitudes. Afwaj, right? The plural of the word fold. فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. Then worship your Lord and praise Him and seek forgiveness. إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. Indeed, He is most forgiving. And Allama Nawawi, the great Shafi'i scholar in Riyad al-Salihin, he brings this ayah in support of the chapter where a person should exert himself more in worship to the latter part of his life. Of course, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's entire life was in worship, and then in Ramadan it was more than outside Ramadan, and then in the last 10 days it was more than the first 20 days, and in the latter part of his life it was more intense than the former. So at no point it was average, it was at optimum at every point, but he just continued exerting and exerting himself. So that was again a verse of the Quran. فقد سأل عمر رضي الله عنه ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما عن هذه الآية إذا جاء نصر الله فقال أجل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أعلمه إياه فقال ما أعلم منها إلا ما تعلم. The famous hadith regarding this year when Sayyidina Umar رضي الله عنه would allow Ibn Abbas in his gathering, and then some prominent elderly senior Sahaba, they took exception to this. They took exception to this and they said, لِمَ يَدْخُلْ هَذَا مَعَنَا وَلَنَا أَبْنَاءٌ مِثْلُهُ. لِمَ يَدْخُلْ هَذَا مَعَنَا وَلَنَا أَبْنَاءٌ مِثْلُهُ. How strange that this is a young lad, Ibn Abbas, and he sits with prominent giants, legends, stalwarts, veterans of Badr and Uhud and the likes, and he is young, and our children are of his age. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu silenced their reservation by proving the profound nature of the knowledge and the caliber of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Then he engaged him on this question and he said, this ayah releases a hint about the demise of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the verse is not explicit to say Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to pass away. It's saying, وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسِ, you will see people coming in droves and scores and multitude, which indicates the accomplishment of your mission. Mission done, work achieved. So it's time to move on. فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ. Then seek the forgiveness of your Lord and glorify Him. إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا. وَفِي رِوَايَةِ الطَّبْرَانِ, and in the narration of Tabrani it comes, Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما says, نُعِيَتْ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ نَفْسُهُ حِينَ نَزَلَتْ فَأَخَذَ بِأَشَدِّ مَا كَانَ قَطُّ إِجْتِهَادًا فِي أَمْرِ الْآخِرَةِ. That this ayah gave a message to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself about his death, because the verse was revealed on him like Allah says, I swear an oath on your Lord, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that is Allah, but Allah, out of the respect of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, fala wa rabbik la'amruka innahum lafi sakratihim ya'mahun, fala wa rabbik, by the oath of your Lord. So in this verse, in this chapter, Allah conveyed the message of the death of the Prophet ﷺ in a verse of the Quran, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma makes mention, and this has been captured in Tabrani. Now when we look at the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we will share with you one hadith today inshaAllah. قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها إن كنا أزواج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عنده جميعا لم تغادر منا واحدة. One day we all were sitting, or whenever I read this, I just get emotional, the entire consorts and the entire spouses of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have a head of state and probably all the first ladies and dignitaries and wives and queens and princess and the rest of it, and be it as it may, it doesn't make a difference to me. These are the spouses. They are the noblest of women who inhabited the earth. One hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that ما زوجت شيئا من بناتي ولا زوجت شيئا من نسائي إلا بوحي جاءني به جبريل عن ربي عز وجل. That I did not select any spouse for myself, nor did I choose any partner for my daughter, but through the affirmation and confirmation of revelation which Jibril brought to me. So in other words, the son-in-laws of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu al-As ibn Rabi, Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, and all the honorable spouses, wives and consorts of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam were the choices of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we were sitting together, a reunion not of a family, not of in school 30 years ago and 40 years nowadays it's a big thing having these reunions, etc. A reunion of the consorts of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فأقبلت فاطمة رضي الله عنها. Fatima رضي الله عنها comes along. ولا والله ما تخفي مشيتها من مشية رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Her walk. ما تخطئ مشيتها من مشية رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Her walk was precisely the walk of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when she would walk, Fatima radiallahu anha, it would be exactly the same. You know what you see? Nabi alayhi salam's walk was like he was descending from a flight of stairs. It was brisk, it was upright, yet it had a humble approach and a humble angle to it. فَلَمَّا رَآهَا رَحَّبَ. When he saw some seen her, he welcomed her. And the hadith of Abu Dawud, he would always stand up, vacate his seat, and then kiss her hand. And this was the interaction that he had with Fatima. One day he was sitting with Fatima radiallahu anha, and there was a knock on the door. And he said, إِنَّهَا لَدَقُّ فَاطِمَ وَلَقَدْ أَتَتْنَا فِي سَاعَةٍ مَا عُوَّدَتْنَا أَن تَأْتِينَا فِي مِثْلِ. That knock is my Fatima knocking. And this is an unusual time for my Fatima to come. It's some need that has driven my Fatima to come. Can you imagine the love, the closeness, the muhabbat, the affection, the intimacy, and the relationship that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had for Fatima radiallahu anha. Marhaban bi ibnati, welcome, O my daughter. Faqadaha bi yameenihi, he made her sit on his right side. Thumma sarraha, then he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam whispered something to Fatima radiallahu anha privately. All the azwaj were sitting, spouses. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took Fatima in her ears and then whispered something to her. فَبَكَتْ, she cried. ثُمَّ سَارَّهَا فَضَحِكَتْ, then he whispered again something and she smiled and she was cheerful and she was radiant and she was happy and she was elated. فَقُلْتُ, Aisha radiallahu anha said, I engaged Fatima radiallahu anha and I said, خَصَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِالصِّرَارِ وَأَنْتِ تَبْكِينَ فَلَمَّا أَنْ قَامَتْ قُلْتُ لَهَا أَخْبِرِينِي مَا سَارَّكَ. I said to Fatima radiallahu anha, the Nabi of Allah had a private word with you, an exclusive word with you. When Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam left the gathering, what was it? He said something, I observed your facial. You know, sometimes a person is reading a letter and you just see tears trickle down, or he receives a message and you can just sense he's become uneasy. Or person receives a message and you can just see that good news or that happiness manifesting on his face. So you have not yet read the contents of that message, but the facial expressions, what they say in mantiq, dalalati ghair lafziyya wad'iyya, dalalati ghair lafziyya wad'iyya, where there's an indication, dalala, ghair lafziyya, it's not explicit, it's not verbalized, wad'iyya, but the expression is loud, it's compelling, it's convincing. You know for a fact that that's the reality. So Aisha radiallahu anha asked Fatima radiallahu anha, please share with me what is, what was the secret that you had with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Fatima radiallahu anha said, ma kuntu li ufshi sirra rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will not divulge the secret of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will not divulge it. And I think here we need to also understand, you know, the famous incident where Anas radiallahu anhu ran at the age of 10. He was given in the khidmah of Nabi alayhi salam till the age of 20 when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away and he was 20 years of age. And then his mother once asked him, Umme Sulaim, who was the mum of Anas radiallahu anha. And her sister was Rumaysa. So her mum asked, Umme Sulaim radiallahu anha asked Anas radiallahu anhu, What were you discussing with Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And he replied that this was a secret between me and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the mother said, don't divulge that secret to me or to anyone else. And she respected the confidentiality of that discussion. So just to conclude on this hadith, that Aisha radiallahu anha asked Fatima, what was the secret all about? There was a tear and then there was a sense of joy. And she said, I will not divulge the secret of Nabi alayhi sallam. Subsequently, when the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, then Aisha radiallahu anha said, my curiosity was still bothering me to find out what was mentioned to Fatima radiallahu anha, and I quizzed her for the second time. Subsequently, I engaged her again. So she said, ammal an fa na'am. Now it's fine because the Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had moved on. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to me, sarrani fil awwal qala li inna Jibril kana yu'aridhuni fil Qur'ani kulla sana marra. That every year Jibreel would come and he would rehearse the Quran with me, muraja'ah, as we would do, a hafiz would do in Ramadan, and ideally throughout your life we would do muraja'ah. Jibreel would rehearse the Quran with me once, but oh my daughter Fatima, this year he rehearsed the Quran with me twice, and the way I understand, wala ara dhalika illa iqtiraba ajali, that this is an indication to the fact that my time has come to an end and I will be moving on. فَاتَّقِ اللَّهَ وَاصْبِرِ. So fear Allah and hold on to patience. And when I heard this, I obviously cried and I broke down and I was emotional and rightfully so. فَنِعْمَ السَّلَفْ أَنَا لَكِ. فَنِعْمَ السَّلَفْ, I'm the best predecessor for you. I'm the best predecessor for you. I'm the best to go ahead for you. فَرَط in Arabic also means one who goes ahead. اللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْهُ لَنَا Faratan, one who goes ahead and takes care of all matters. فَنِعْمَ السَّلَفُ أَنَا لَكِ, I'm your best predecessor. فَبَكَيْتْ ثُمَّ سَارَّنِي. Then he whispered to me again and he said, أَمَا تَرْضَيْنِ, are you not pleased أَن تَكُونِي, are you not happy that Allah has made you the queen of the woman of Jannah? فَضَحِكْتْ, and then I smiled. So that was again a hadith which was quite clear, explicit in its mention, that the Prophet ﷺ had indicated to his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha that his time has come to an end. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with a good death. We ask Allah to make us at the time that when it's our time to leave this world, it is in a condition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with us and we are longing and we are yearning and we are pining to meet Allah. Like the Arabic poet said, you arrived in this world and you were crying and those around you were laughing. Let it be the day you leave this world, you are smiling and those around you are crying. Wa sallallahumma wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.